If you want to record a full band with 24 inputs and 6 stereo headphone mixes, or if you want to use a rack of outboard gear for mixing, that means you're going to need a huge 32x32 interface, right? Well, actually no. Thanks to digital audio protocols, you can use a relatively affordable audio interface with only 2 or 4 mic preamps and expand your interface to suit your needs for years to come. In this video, I'll show you some ideas for how you can choose an interface or use your existing interface to do much more than you'd assume was possible by simply looking at the number of mic preamps and analog I/O on the device itself. Thanks to RME for sponsoring this video and supporting audio education. First, let me explain what I mean by analog I/O, because you can do a lot with more analog inputs and outputs. There are a few common analog audio inputs and outputs that you'll find on an audio interface. There are line inputs and line outputs, which are generally used for connecting line-level audio devices together. Line outputs can be used to connect an external mixer or headphone amplifier for creating a headphone mix for a performer, or they can also be used to connect your external recording device or streaming device. Line inputs can receive audio from other line-level audio devices, such as receiving a signal from a playback device. You can then pair together both a line output and a line input to integrate outboard effects. For example, send a line level signal out of your interface's line output into the line input on an outboard compressor, compress the audio signal, and then connect the line output of the compressor back into the line input on the audio interface. If you need to connect a source that is not line level, it will probably fall into one of two categories: instrument level or microphone level. And for these types of signals, you'll typically need a preamp that will bring that instrument or mic level signal up to line level. An instrument level signal comes from an instrument, like a guitar pickup. These signals are high Z, or high impedance, and they require either a DI box or a dedicated instrument input. Mic level signals come from microphones or DI boxes. They're low Z, or low impedance, but very weak. Therefore, they require a preamp. The preamp doesn't necessarily need to be built into the audio interface. You could use an external preamp between the source and the line input on the audio interface. The preamp converts the impedance and boosts the signal level up to line level. The problem is that you may eventually need a ton of analog I/O to accommodate all of the sources and outboard gear in your studio. But rather than throwing out your audio interface with 2x2 analog I/O, replacing it with an 8x8 audio interface, then replacing that with a 16x16 audio interface, and so on, this is where digital I/O can help. On this RME Fireface UCX2, I have 2 mic line inputs, 2 instrument line inputs, and 4 line inputs. And on the output side, I've got 6 line outputs. These all go straight to my patch bay, so I can use them for different purposes, depending on the situation. But when I need more than these 8 analog inputs and 6 analog outputs will accommodate, I can use these optical ADAT connections. These allow for an additional 8 inputs and 8 outputs to and from ADAT-enabled devices. For example, I've got this RME 12 mic Dante. It's a microphone preamp with ADAT outputs. By connecting the ADAT output of the 12 mic Dante to the ADAT input on my audio interface, I can bring in 8 of these mic preamps, giving me a total of 16 analog inputs, 8 analog inputs on the interface, and 8 analog inputs on my ADAT device. Another way to use ADAT is to expand the outputs beyond what's available with built-in analog connections. One example of when you need a lot of outputs is for immersive audio setups. Let's say you want a 7x1x4 system. That's 7 ear level speakers, 1 subwoofer, and 4 height speakers. A total of 12 speakers. Therefore, I'd need 12 line outputs. If I had a 7.1.4 setup in my room, I'd probably use 4 of my built-in analog outputs, and then I'd get an external 8-channel DA converter with ADAT connectivity. That would give me the 12 outputs I need, and a special bonus with RME is that I'd also have a delay and room EQ on every one of those channels. The main problem in my studio when it comes to ADAT is that the UCX2 only has 1 ADAT input and 1 ADAT output. But I've got 2 preamps and also an 8-channel ADAT 500 series rack, with some 500 series modules. That means I'd need to disconnect and reconnect the ADAT connections each time I wanted to use a new device. Currently, I make this process a bit easier by using this RME Digiface USB as an ADAT switcher. All of my ADAT devices connect to this, and then I can load a preset to quickly select which device actually gets sent to the ADAT input on my audio interface. In fact, the Digiface USB is an audio interface alone. If I only used ADAT devices, this could be my main audio interface, even though it doesn't have any built-in analog I/O. That would provide me with 32 ins and 32 outs through ADAT devices. But I choose to use it as a switcher for now because I like some of the additional features of the UCX2 as well as the analog I/O. The ideal solution would be to upgrade to a device like the RME UFX3, which has two ADAT inputs and two ADAT outputs. This interface also has the additional features that I enjoy on my current interface, like reverb, echo, room EQ and delay on each output channel, and EQ and dynamics on every channel. And as you can see, there are a lot of other connections that I'd get by upgrading to an interface like the UFX3. Side note, RME is the sponsor of this video, and they are a big supporter of our channel and audio education in general. However, most of these principles I'm teaching you also apply to some other interfaces from different manufacturers. It's really important to me that you find my videos helpful, no matter if you choose to support my sponsors or not. So if you're finding this video helpful, give the video a like, and if you're interested in the RME interfaces that I've mentioned, check out the links in the description below the video. Hopefully you've started to see that even a simple digital connection like ADAT can be very powerful. You can find ADAT inputs on a variety of small two-channel interfaces, which is a good way to future-proof your setup, even if you don't intend to use it on day one. But when you need more than 8 or 16 channels of extra I/O, you may find something like MADI to be more useful. MADI can support up to 64 input and output channels, which already sets it apart from ADAT. But there's another key difference to keep in mind. As opposed to ADAT, which is a point-to-point connection, MADI can be used to integrate several devices together. If you only have two devices, such as a converter and an interface, you can use either a fiber optic or a coaxial cable between the two devices, and this would give you up to 64 channels in one direction. If you wanted to add an additional 64 channels in the opposite direction, you could simply create a ring between the two devices. The ring topology can then facilitate additional devices, which is a big advantage over ADAT. This means now you can have 128 channels of audio that can be picked off and utilized by any device in the ring. Let's say you've got an RME UFX3 and four converters that each have 16 line inputs and 16 line outputs, such as the RME M1620 Pros. Connecting the output of each device to the input of the next will create a ring and give you the ability to route audio between each device. That could mean you're getting 64 channels in and out of your interface with the analog I/O on each device, but these devices often have digital I/O aside from MADI. As you can see here, the M1620 Pros each have ADAT inputs and outputs of their own, which could be routed to your interface via MADI. If you didn't need the analog I/O built into the audio interface, you could go with something like the RME MADI Face USB. This interface doesn't have any analog I/O, but it supports 64 channels in and 64 channels out via MADI, or 128 channels in a single direction. When I learned about this way of doing things, I started to understand the idea of the backbone of a studio, rather than restricting my imagination to the analog or even the ADAT I/O built into the audio interface itself. Connecting these hub devices to your audio interface via MADI allows you to get more analog and digital I/O without needing a gigantic audio interface with all of that I/O built in. That saves you money and keeps everything much more streamlined because there are no USB or Thunderbolt drivers needed for the other devices. All of the audio just funnels into your interface, which has the drivers and the more advanced virtual routing and mixing features. It also gives you a lot more flexibility because you can just swap things out over time as technology and your needs evolve. Let's say you had an RME FireWire interface and you have to upgrade your computer which won't have a firewire connection. Rather than having to replace the entire system, you just swap out the firewire interface with something that has USB or Thunderbolt, and everything else can stay connected as is. On the flip side, imagine that you need more ADAT I/O sometime in the future. Rather than shopping for a new audio interface, you can just simply replace or add in a converter with ADAT connections. Of course, if you're watching this video and thinking, why would I ever need that much I/O, then you're not the target demographic for this particular example, or MADI in general, I'd say. But the same general mindset applies. If you get an interface with ADAT inputs and outputs, you can bolt things on in the future to accommodate different needs that you don't necessarily have on day one. ADAT and MADI have been around for quite some time, and they're both still used in many studio setups. But the latest digital audio protocols, like Dante, AVB, and Ravenna, take things up a notch. Rather than being restricted to audio being transmitted over special purpose cabling, some of these audio over IP protocols let you use a network switch. And that switch can be isolated to just supporting the audio system, or it can be a part of an existing network throughout a building. For example, the RME Digiface Dante has 4 Dante ports. This alone can be used as the network switch, or it can be connected to a larger network. The primary advantage of network protocols like Dante, beyond the higher channel counts, is that they can operate with a much more flexible topology. Just connect a Dante device to the network and then route them with the free Dante controller software. This is powerful not only in studio settings, but also in live sound or AV setups that you'd find in concert venues, corporate offices, and schools. When new requirements emerge, there's no need to rewire anything. You just use the existing network cable and the device shows up as a new source or a destination. I hope you're beginning to see how all of this works together to provide more options for more situations. And I'd encourage you to learn more about each of these protocols if you're interested in working in Pro Audio. In the next video, that's on your screen now, we'll go into more detail as to how each of these protocols work and how you might use them in different situations. I'll see you there.